I have an idea of all the stuff I could do if there were no laws about whiskey and someone gave me carte blanche to study. And when I went to Prince Edward County for the first time, like 4 years ago, I realized that these guys were doing all of that stuff. They came into the industry in the lab and said, right, first things first, we want to put all of our whiskey into aquamarine bottles. We want to color code our whiskey because, well, let's face it, our name root line is quite difficult to see. So we'd much rather be able to go into a bar and say, can I get the aquamarine one, please? We decided to try and modernize the packaging. We brought all that stuff in there. But then, behind the scenes, we also had all these other experiments going on. We had it in our mind that one distillery does not have to make one style of whiskey. If you're going to make whiskey for the whole world, then yes, okay, you have to standardize something, you have to speed some things up. You have to essentially guess what's going to happen in the head of the round. That's the way the Scotch whiskey industry works. If you do everything on a small batch basis, then you have a lot more freedom. So at Brooklady, we have three different levels of peat in our valley. So that itself gives us different things to do. The standard Brooklady's are unpeated. The Port Charlotte's that you'll find later on, heavily repeated. We do another whiskey called Octomore, which is the heaviest peated whiskey in the world. And again, it was a conversation with the pub that led to that. We also decided to do lots of different cask finishes, and that led to one of the, have anything heard of the Buffalo Trace wood experiment? The old single barrel, small bottles, it was 192 of them to try. So it's a very difficult collection to complete. We did something akin to that, nothing as crazy as that, but we decided to take all of the 16-year-old spirits sitting in our warehouse and start to finish it off and see what we could create. And we did the first group of wine series, so that was six. We had these 16, so we finished off in the first group of the old barrels. Each one has its own subtlety, absolutely gorgeous collection of whiskey. Those will be running out, so we're not going to see them again, but again, we still have them in the Midwest for some reason, so we'll get to them. We did a sherry range, a 16-year-old, where we brought in different sherry casks and tried to finish them. But by far the craziest thing that we did, which was like my favourite from the range, was we took a bourbon cask whiskey, and we finished it in a bourbon cask. We took tired Jim Beam barrels, and we brought one of those really good quality casks over from, or more than one, we brought up. So actually it's really good quality casks over from the Buffalo Trace. And what you have in your hand is the result of that experiment. It's, in my view, the ultimate bourbon cask whiskey.
Started to end.
Bringing pipe work into white buildings and corrugated roofs. actually not visit the Berlin CIA. He ran to make sure we were not producing weapons of mass destruction. So what Jim decided to do was to pick his favourite pass from the warehouse at the time and do a small batch of WMD. He sent a piece of it to the Berlin CIA. Now that's a pretty impressive story. I mean, you can't make that kind of stuff up. 2 years later, a yellow one-man submarine washed up just outside the city. We phoned up the Ministry of Defence in the UK and we said, thank you for your submarine. And as the Ministry of Defence did, he turned around and said, nothing to do with us. We said to them, it says the Ministry of Defence at the back. So we told them we were going to take it, we would salvage it, we would claim it. We sat around for 2 weeks before they finally admitted the gap, when they finally admitted that something wrong. They decided they were going to send one of the nuclear subs out to actually pick up this other sub. They decided they didn't want anyone to know about it. They decided they were going to show up at 4 o'clock in the morning. What they didn't expect is that the entire workforce for the party, the entire village, Port Charlotte, and the local pipe band would be there for 5 minutes. And the last thing that they decided that they were expecting was for us to have a second motion of weapons of mass destruction called the Yellow Submarine. And we presented the captain of the submarine in a piece of it. And it was this wonderful picture. Percy Hero standing in a piece of it, supposed to be a big grin on his face. And it's the submarine command is that it's absolutely fine, so far as it costs the castle. Because the rest of the MV, they will have to find out who has screwed up with that. But that's kind of good.